What's up guys, Nate Vincent here with FCP Euro. We are in my personal garage. I'm going to be walking you through the process of how to replace the rear pads and rotors on a Volvo C30 T5. We're going to be using Akebono dust-free ceramic pads and Zimmerman rotors. This is a really good combination. The kit is available on fcpeuro.com, and let's get started. We're going to just crank the lugs loose with a normal socket while the car is still on the ground. What I mean by loose is we're going to turn them about 90 degrees, no more than that. We don't want the wheel falling off, but we want to make sure that the wheel will come off once it's in the air and it can rotate. Got my 19 millimeter wrench. Let's do some cranking. So by cracking them loose, what I'm talking about is, wow, these things are pretty tight. I'm going to use a little foot power. That's it. That's all you need to do. Just a little rotation. Make sure you get all of them. So now, next step is we're going to lift the rear of the car up. We're going to get the entire rear axle, meaning the right and left rear wheel, off the ground. Slide some jack stands under there for safety, and then we can dig into this wheel. Personally, I love jacking the rear of front-wheel drive cars up because it is that simple. There is a cross beam across the back. All you have to watch out for is the muffler. Put the jack right in the middle of that cross beam and lift the car up. Could not get simpler than this. Now remember, we're just doing a brake service job, so we just really want to get the wheels off the ground. Taking the jack without actually putting my body under the car. Oh no. Grab the other. Sorry, my jack stands don't match. I know. Go right to that side of the beam. So what I'm doing here is I am placing the jack stands right to the inside of the sway bar mounts on the rear beam. Now we have the jack stands positioned properly. We're gonna let the car down. Keeping it on it the whole way. And the weight is off the jack, so I'm just actually gonna leave the jack right here just for safe measures. Next up, we're gonna pull this wheel off and we're gonna take a really close look at how bad these brakes actually are. We'll set this aside. So now looking at these brakes, they're pretty beat up. There's a lot of rust around the rotor. The pad thickness looks decent. It's a little bit worn out, not super bad. But yeah, we're gonna pull this apart. Obviously this has an emergency brake that's connected to the rear wheels. So we're gonna have to be careful about that, making sure that the caliper is moved to the correct location. That's the handbrake cable there. It's a little rust on it at the end, so I'm gonna keep a close eye on that. Other than that, just kind of inspecting for general rust. It looks pretty good. There's a little bit of rust on the seam, a little bit of rust here. I wouldn't worry about anything as far as structural, but it's something we wanna keep an eye on just for future to make sure it doesn't get any worse. There's obviously a lot of products we can put on that just to keep it from getting any worse as well. And now it's time to get the brake rotor off. So the first step we're gonna do here is we're actually gonna pull this anti-rattle clip out, and this really just kind of connects the caliper carrier here with the caliper itself. They actually need to move independent of each other, but this keeps it from rattling. Best way to do that is with a flathead screwdriver. So thumb on here, go right underneath here, and you can simply just pop it out. Has a little bit of spring to it, so be careful, be ready for it, and it pops out just like that. And then you can just kind of wiggle out the other side, and there you go. We'll clean this and reinstall it, so set that aside. Next thing I'm going to do is basically, we have these pins, one right here up in the top portion of the caliper, one right here on the lower portion of the caliper, and those pins thread from here through the caliper. They pass through the caliper and they thread into the carrier right here. And it's what locates this rotor, it's what locates this caliper and allows it to move in and out as the pads, slowly wear down. And also as this caliper clamps, it allows the caliper to clamp evenly on the right and left side of the rotor. So the way we remove that is we pop these little plastic plugs, right, like that, right off from behind, like that. Once we have those plastic plugs off, you'll see there's actually a seven millimeter Allen. You can see the 7 millimeter Allen inside that. We'll come up to the top. I don't know if you can see it there. Before we go ahead and remove that Allen, one thing I want to point out. That's good. Let me see.
Ooh,
that's great. Before we remove these two pins and this caliper becomes loose, I'm gonna pop this off and I'm gonna put a 10 millimeter on here and just make sure that this bleeder comes loose. Bleeding the brakes is really, really critical. So I'm basically gonna pop this on here and I'm going to just make sure that this bleeder comes loose while this caliper is mounted. Very, very gently giving this a little bit of tap, making sure it's not breaking. Remember the bleeder is a hollow. Oh, and I can see a drop coming off of it. So you can see a couple drops coming off. So I know I was able to loosen it. Now I'm gonna carefully tighten this thing back up. Notice I'm using a relatively short wrench. Don't wanna put too much stress on it. So now I know, wipe that off with a rag, the ground. Now I know that the bleeder comes loose. So we're good to go there. So now, next step is, you can put the little dust cover back on. We are going to actually remove the caliper from the carrier. So like I said before, we're going to use a ratchet and a 7 millimeter socket. You can use, if you have just normal L-shaped metric Allen keys, they will work as well. So you don't necessarily need a socket. Socket just makes this job a little bit easier. So coming up to the top one, without busting my knuckle, we're going to loosen that up. That's pretty loose right away. Come out of the bottom one, make sure that one loosens up. Good. And if you look in that crack right here, you're actually gonna see the pins start to separate and rotate. So you can see what I'm talking about. This pin goes right through this caliper and threads into this carrier right here. Now obviously when we reassemble this, we wanna use a good amount of grease on these pins to make sure this caliper can move nicely. All right, and that looks like it's loose. Doesn't seem like this pin wants to slide out, so we'll have to just pull the caliper and see what the pin will do afterwards. Now coming up to the top, I'm actually just gonna pop the socket off because this one was pretty loose already. And just loosen it by hand, giving the caliper a couple wiggles to make sure it's free. So on this car, we obviously, before we remove the caliper, we wanna make sure the handbrake is not applied, because the handbrake on this car actually applies through the caliper, which means it's gonna squeeze the caliper and the caliper is basically gonna be clamped onto the rotor at that point. So we wanna make sure that is released before we go to remove this caliper from this rotor. And you can see this pin is coming out the way it's supposed to. And I'll hold that in front of you guys so you can see it, but there's the pin, threaded on one end, Allen key on the other. Obviously, we'll clean that up very carefully and reinstall that when we're done. We should be able to wiggle this rotor a little bit on this caliper, which it seems to be doing. You can see it's kind of freeing up a little bit. So I'm basically just pulling, the piston is in this portion of the caliper. So I'm just basically holding the rotor on there and pulling the caliper towards me to release some of that tension. And at that point, we should be able to pop this up and off. There we go. So now we have separated the caliper and you can see this was that kind of stubborn pin that didn't want to come out. I'm just going to take my little mallet and I'm going to give that a couple whaps. There we go. Starting to come out. I'm doing that with a very soft rubber mallet. A trick, if they don't want to come out, you can take your Allen, stick your Allen in there and kind of pull and rotate at the same time. And there you go. Popped it out. So make sure to put some grease on there. They should not be that sticky. They should slide pretty easily in and out. And the last thing we're gonna do is we're gonna get this caliper up and out of the way. So anything you can really do just to sort of get that caliper safely up and out of the way, and making sure the key here is making sure that the stress isn't in this line. We don't want it hanging all on the brake line or, you know, the emergency brake line. So the next thing we're gonna do is just remove the two pads. The pads are basically just sat in here on the carrier. We will note that the inside pad here has this nice little spring on it, this little butterfly spring. So just remember the inside pad has the butterfly spring. Obviously that pad has a bit of thickness on it, but could be replaced. I'm also noticing this is a genuine Volvo pad, so that's giving me a little bit of idea of who serviced this car. I'm assuming it was probably serviced at a dealership. Now pulling in the outboard pad's a little more worn than the inboard pad. That's usually the opposite of what you see, so I am just suspect that this caliper is maybe possibly a little sticky or something happened. All right, the next thing we're gonna do is to get the rotor off, the rotor, we need to get this carrier bracket off. There is two 13 millimeter bolts here. They're pretty rusty and they're pretty nasty, so I'm gonna use one of my favorite wrenches. Just a nice long 13 with a box end on it. I'm really gonna wiggle this thing properly to make sure it's seated. Is that a 13 or is that a 12? And it's so rusty, it almost feels like a 12, but it's a 13. So we gotta be really, really careful with this bolt. Had I known this was this bad getting into it, I would have actually opted for brand new bolts here. I'm gonna give this a little bit of a whap with my palm of my hand just to loosen this up a little bit. All right, we're loose there. Now coming down to the bottom one, same sort of thing, yep. So you can see now, once we get this loose, the carrier bracket will be able to come loose. For safekeeping, I usually thread the bolts back into the carrier bracket. Just keeps you from losing them, keeps everything organized as you're doing the job. Obviously, that's one of the trickier aspects of doing more complicated jobs, is the more fasteners that, and more brackets and things like that that need to come loose, the more you need to keep track of during the process. There we go. So thread that one back in. And we're gonna do the same to the other side. Luckily, this brake kit came with a whole can of CRC brake clean, so this car is really gonna need it. Obviously, you can see there's a lot of corrosion and rust and debris on this thing that we're gonna clean up before we reinstall. Next up here is we're gonna remove the rotor. So slide this off, and there we go. There's the old rotor, and it is pretty nasty, if I say so myself. I'm also noticing here, it's a little concerning that the inside of this, the inside, the piston side, is barely worn. But the outside seems a little bit more worn. I'm not sure if we have a stuck caliper or a sticky caliper, something like that. But these are things I'm noticing as I'm working on this car to sort of just earmark in my head. If that piston doesn't go back nicely in that caliper, we may have a caliper issue. You can see all that nasty rust on this rotor. Around this backing plate is really pretty gross, all the way down the bottom. So had I known this was this bad, I would have bought new fasteners and new backing plates. Obviously, F-Superior is the source for that stuff. Looking at this, the wheel bearing's not looking all that hot either. It functions fine, but that outer portion's pretty flaked up with rust, as you can see there. And obviously, if you're gonna replace the backing plate, it makes sense to replace the wheel bearing at the same time. Good maintenance to do on a higher mileage car, especially if you're gonna do any autocrossing, any track stuff, anything where you're gonna put any significant stress on the car. I recommend doing it on all cars, period, end of story. We're going to slide this piston back on this caliper and make sure it seats back and where it's supposed to sit. What I'm going to do before we do that is I'm going to clean all around these edges here. Let me make sure that was in frame. Kind of was. Let's go a little higher. The other thing is I'm going to show you without any specialty tools how you can thread this piston back in. So you can see this piston is actually threaded because of the handbrake, and I'm going to show you how to deal with that. So right now I'm just kind of cleaning off all this dust and looking in here, seeing if there's any nasty places that the screwdriver gets caught. I'm being very, very ginger with the backing, not the rubber dust seal here, to make sure I'm not tearing it. So you don't wanna just go full on, and you really wanna be soft and ginger. And I'm gonna give that a quick spray and try to capture it, because I don't want brake cleaner going everywhere, and just get that nice and clean. So let's give that a go. All right, so we're gonna have to thread this piston back in using these two holes to keep it located. So let me show you that close up, threading the piston. So we're gonna turn this piston in. So it's basically gonna thread in, but we're gonna have to leverage these two holes to turn it. So there is special tools made for this that fit right in there, fit up to your socket, make it super, super easy. If you have one, totally suggest using it. It will save so much time. It'll make your life that much easier. If you don't have it, there's a couple of different things you can do. First, if you have snap ring pliers or a set of needle nose pliers, you can use those. So you can see I can actually take these pliers and I can put it right in there, and that allows me to rotate this piston. So that's really a great option. Another option, if you don't have anything like that, if you can find a pin pick or a screwdriver small enough, you can basically put a screwdriver or a pick in one and the other, and then you can rotate around. Using this little setup, I'm going to basically that's not going anywhere. There we go, it's starting to move. It's really being stubborn though. I left these outside, but able to get a little bit of torque on there and get it in those holes. Also, if you're doing this job on a Saturday and you can't find these things, you could get these at a home improvement store or something of that nature, which would allow you to keep moving forward with your project without stalling. So lock those down, adjustable wrench, and thread it in. Nice. So I can see it's moving pretty easily. So it is moving pretty freely. There is a little bit of friction behind it, but it is moving, so that's good. So I'm just gonna slowly kind of move this in and keep an eye on how everything is looking. As you're doing this, you're gonna need to push down and rotate, just like you're tightening a bolt down, rotate clockwise to make this thread in. And another tip I have is if you're not sure it's threading in, grab a nice straight edge, something like this. So right there, we are 36 millimeters. Can't really see it, sorry, the glare is terrible. But you can do that, do a little work, and then come back and measure it again. Make sure you're making progress, because if you don't push down enough, you're not going to engage the thread. And if you don't engage the thread, you're just going to sit here and spin all day long and not make any progress. If you plan on doing this more than once, just buy the stupid tool. That is my advice.
A few inches later,
we have the Zimmerman rotor. We want to make sure that the mating surface is extremely clean before installing this rotor. So all around here, really want to make sure that this is perfectly clean. This is a good time if you have a wire brush to give it a quick wire brush, and you're not going to have any offset or anything squeezed in between there. So let's slide this on. Pretty simple. Awesome. Really nice fit. I'm going to take one of the standard lugs and I'm just going to thread that on and just use that as a locator to make sure this stays nice and tight. So here we're just going to clean up this carrier right here. My oil drain pan out here just so I can use some brake clean and not worry about making a huge mess on the floor. First things first though, I'm going to wire brush this thing down, try to get it as clean as I possibly can. And we're gonna use some brake clean and some rags. Key elements that you wanna make sure are clean on this are gonna be the two surfaces that the pads sit on, so right here and here. You also wanna make sure the threads for the pins are good and clean, right here and here. And the last thing, see this silver non-rusted area here? This is actually where it mates up against the hub, the upright, and you wanna make sure that's good, because what you want is this to mate up nice and square. You don't want it to be cockeyed, because obviously if the thing is tweaked a little bit, then the pads aren't gonna be tweaked, the caliper's gonna be tweaked, everything's gonna be off a little bit. So like I said, we're going over here to the mating surface, which is actually, remember, going to be on the rotor side of this. And I'm just making sure there's no rust or debris on there. Same with the top one. Make sure that's good and clean. And clean off anything that's loose. Just get it off of there. And then we're gonna take the fasteners out. Set them down right there. Both fasteners are off. Now we have the carrier. We're going to mount the carrier in place and reinstall the fasteners. I'm gonna take my 13 millimeter wrench on the 13 millimeter side, not the 12 millimeter side. I'm gonna give that good tightening. And again on the bottom, same deal. Nice and tight. Make sure that the caliper isn't making contact, or the rotor isn't making contact with the caliper carrier when you push it up against the hub. And now we're gonna get out our brake pads. So right here, I have the Akebono brake pads and the box that I stepped on. My apologies, it's a little bit busted open. Let's pull them out. Here they are. Now remember, we had two that had the butterflies, two that don't. So I'm gonna take these two for the other side, put them back in the box. Now remember, we noted this, but the one with the butterfly spring is going to go inboard. The one without is gonna go outboard. And we're gonna quickly just kind of test them, make sure they go in their correct places. They do. So the next thing we're gonna do is we're going to apply the grease, starting out with the caliper. I'm gonna get a little bit on my finger here. Stuff is goopy, and I'm just gonna go right around the face of the caliper. So right around where we had those holes, and a little bit on the boot to make sure the boots stay nice and lubricated and the piston, you really do not want the piston rusting. If the piston rusts every time it comes out and basically gets retracted, it's going to get sticky, and eventually you're going to get a seized caliper and you're going to have bigger issues down the road. So now moving on from the piston, this stuff is goopy. I'm going to go to the other side, the caliper surface. So this is what it's going to, the caliper piston is going to push against. So I got one side done and the other side done. Now coming over here, I'm going to pull the pad out. I'm going to make sure I get a good amount sort of on the end. And in this particular scenario, I'm just going to look at exactly where the pad kind of makes contact, so right around there. Kind of earmark it off, and then I'm just going to put it right on the pad itself. So I'm not making a huge mess out of this. So it's on that side of the pad. I'm going to repeat it and mirror it over on the other side. So right there, it's mirrored on. And then making sure it's going to have a little contact on the top portion. So looking at that right there, make sure we get a little grease on that. And with my few clean fingers, I'm going to slide this thing in place. So one pad ready to go. Now we're going to do the exact same thing to the opposite side. So goop on the wings of the pad and a little bit on the spring. The spring is actually going to make contact with the caliper. We want to make sure that doesn't make a funny vibration. And then last but not least, taking the clean fingers, we're going to make sure we install the pad friction surface to the rotor so we don't have any issues down the road. It is time to cut our zip tie and reinstall our caliper right on this nice assembly here, keeping the grease on standby because we may need it for our pins still. So here we go. I'm going to take the entire caliper assembly. We're going to cut the zip tie here without cutting myself. Get the zip tie out of the way. And now we're going to install this. And our measurements seem to have worked correctly. Pushing everything together a little bit here. Make sure everything fits nicely and that there's no significant friction. Oh. So this may be a little tight. You want to be able to push it, but you don't want it to be, you know, holding you up. So you should be able to wiggle everything down. Judging from that, I'm a little concerned that this piston still needs to move back a little bit. It's just a little bit tight, so I'm actually gonna take it back off and just to be certain, I'm gonna give it a couple more, maybe a turn or two more out. Obviously, it's gonna be a little messier now with all the grease on it, but we'll survive. We won't be working on our cars if we don't want to get messy. If you plan on doing this more than once, just buy the stupid tool. That is my advice. And look at that. So much more room.
So much.
You can do aerobics in here.
So many activities.
Do step class.
It's making my head spin how many activities we can do.
So you can see that really made a difference. Okay, wiping off all the debris on the pins. Put a teeny bit of grease on it. Just around the collar. So not on the threads, but right above the threads on the collar. So you can see there, right above the threads. We can go through and get that started. And do the same on the bottom one. All right, and through, push the caliper in. And this one was the one that was sticky before, so gonna require a little bit of force and finesse to get that through. So we just finished up the rear brakes on this and now it's time to bleed them. So I went inside and I got my daughter Isla, who just finished up with bath time, hence the wet hair, and she is going to be my pedal pumper while I bleed the brakes. So basically we're gonna go through, it's gonna be the same process on all four wheels. We're gonna start at the furthest from the master cylinder, so it could be either one of the rears. It's honestly not that important that you go in the correct order. It's really most important that you're actually very careful when you do it. So Motive products here, this is a bleeder. Basically the whole benefit of this is it allows you to get this hose hooked up to the bleeder of the car. So you basically hook it right to the bleeder so you can see the fluid coming out, and then obviously it collects all the extra fluid here. The beauty of that is you can see the air bubbles come out and you can make sure no air bubbles are going back into the system from the caliper. The other thing you're gonna wanna do while you're doing this is make sure that your master cylinder is topped up and you're not sucking air into the system. Last thing you need is some air in your master cylinder or further into your ABS system. Really a pain to get out. So key for DIYers is just to make sure that master cylinder and the ABS unit always are constantly filled with fluid. So if you're flushing the fluid, it should be no big deal. You just really got to make sure the fluid stays in the system. All right, let's get started. Okay, so the key is when daddy says to push the pedal, you push the pedal and you don't pull up on it until I say it's okay to.
Okay.
Got it. Topping up the system, we'll be using the Licomoli .4 fluid. This is not the racing fluid, this is the standard fluid. The racing fluid has a higher wet and dry boiling point, but it also has a higher ability to absorb moisture and cost more. Welcome DIY at home. Stuff falling all over the place. You ready to bleed some brakes?
Yeah.
Do you want the seat back a little bit? Would that make it easier? Sit up a little bit more? Look at how nasty, oh Jesus, light is about to fail. Look at how nasty that brake fluid is in there. That is not where you want it to be. I'm sure its boiling point has been compromised. I'm sure the fluid in general is compromised. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna try to I'm trying to do something, please don't do that, okay? All right, no more. Or I'm gonna get your replacement. All right, I don't know where I was at, but yeah, that brake fluid is pretty nasty. If you look on the side, you can see the minimum level down at the bottom. There is a seal on the fluid, so you can see the seal. We're gonna break that seal off. We really gotta make sure it stays above minimum. If it goes below.
There's an animal seal?
Yeah, there's an animal seal. Like the seal?
Yeah.
Well, it's a seal, like it's a, like it's a sealing crack? Something. What?
Like a crack that they've painted over?
Yeah, like a seal, like that. Yep.
I smell it.
So the bleeder right here, the bleeder cap, I'm just gonna pull that off. It's a 10 millimeter on the back of this car. I like to put the open end of the wrench where I have enough room to turn 90 degrees to loosen. So I can turn it 90 degrees and come back up. So I'm gonna leave that right there like that. And then, the beauty of using one of these bleeders is you can simply take the bleeder hose like that and you can pop it right on here and we're actually gonna be able to physically see the brake fluid coming out and it's gonna catch it in this nice little container all by itself. If you're working in a weird place, you also have this so you can hang it. So if you wanted to hang it from a lug or... Okay, can you hit the brakes and hold it? Are you holding it?
Yep.
Hold. All right, can you pump it up again? Pump it a couple times. One, two, three. And can you hold it? Hold the pedal down. Great job. All right, so we're still getting a lot of air bubbles, but we'll continue doing this and continue topping up the master cylinder until we see nice clean fluid coming out of here and we're not seeing any air bubbles pass through here. So first thing I'm gonna do is get the hose off it and make sure all that brake fluid goes into the bottle so you don't get a mess in there. Love these things, you actually can hook the brake hose back to itself again so you don't get brake fluid everywhere. It just makes life so much easier. Just pop that grommet back on and we're through. Now let's bolt the wheel back on. I'm gonna pull the lug off that I put on just to hold the wheel in place. Lining up the lugs and sliding in, making sure we're up on the hub. Put some pressure on the bottom of the wheel so it doesn't pop off. And we will put the lugs on. So right now I'm tightening these lugs down just by hand, getting the wheel nice and snug and square. Make sure the wheel is snug to the hub and the lugs are as tight as I can get them. Obviously the wheel can rotate because it's jacked up in the air, as you can see, just like that. So once I let it down on the ground, I'm gonna grab a torque wrench and I will finish this off by torquing the wheels to 80 foot-pounds. So after you finish the brakes, a good test to make sure that you don't have anything binding in the rear is you can spin the wheel and see how freely it spins. Another test you can do is make sure that the handbrake works. So let's hop in here real quick. So it requires a couple pulls, but you can see the wheel is locked up. It's not allowing it to move. And then I release the handbrake and the wheel can move freely. So that shows that we have a caliper that's not stuck. It's engaging the handbrake and it's allowing the handbrake to release 100%. All right, so now that we've made sure both jack stands are out from underneath the car, and we're not gonna have an issue with the car getting stuck in one, we're gonna lower the car down and we're gonna be through. All right, guys, I really hope you enjoyed this video. I hope you found it helpful. This is doing the rear brakes on a Volvo P1. This is a C30 T5. The right side would be exactly the same as the left side, so basically do everything exactly the same as we did it over here. Obviously, don't forget to torque your wheels. If you found this video helpful, please give us a thumbs up. If you want to see more content like this, please subscribe to our channel. And if you have any questions, please leave them in the comments below. We'll catch you on the next one. Take it easy.